2017, Tabitha Biagin introduced the world to what was often dubbed the weirdest star ever found. Now simply known as Biagin Star, the strangeness came from photometry, that means measuring the brightness of a star repeatedly. The bizarre dips in brightness defied simple explanation, with some even suggesting this could be an alien megastructure under construction. But after years of hard work, we figured out that it was likely just dust, since the strength of the dips changes with the wavelength in the same telltale pattern that dust usually does. But all along, there has been another weird star, which is arguably much, much weirder, one that remains a complete enigma even today, Przybylski star. Right off the bat, this star is already unusual, being classified by astronomers as an AP-type star. The A there stands for A-type, which just means it's hotter and bigger than the Sun, but the extra P that's been thrown in stands for peculiar, which, trust me, in this case is an understatement. Okay, so then what's the difference between A and AP stars? Most A stars spin fast, as in really fast, typically over 100 kilometers per second. In contrast, AP stars spin much slower. For example, Przybylski's surface is moving at a modest 3.5 kilometers per second, not much faster than the Sun's 2.2 kilometers per second. So, what's going on? We think that effectively all stars are born with fast spins, but sun-like stars slow down over time due to their strong magnetic fields, which capture ionized particles and fling them out at great distances, causing a gradual braking effect. Crucially, A-type stars aren't expected to have strong magnetic fields because their outer envelope should be radiative. That is, energy transfer is dominated by radiation, and thus they're actually fairly quiescent and still. In contrast, cooler sun-like stars have convective envelopes, so it's more like a boiling pot of water, and it's that stirring motion that drives their magnetic dynamo. So the slow rotation of these AP stars is pretty odd, and it implies that they have a strong magnetic field when they really shouldn't. Indeed, for the Przybylski star, that field is measured to be 150 times stronger than that of the Sun. As mysterious as this slow spin is, that's really just par for the course when it comes to these AP-type stars. What really makes Przybylski star stand out amongst this pack of already weird stars is its bizarre chemical composition. For most stars, astronomers can tell what chemical elements are in the stellar atmosphere by doing spectroscopy, the act of splitting light up into its different colors. In doing so, we can see various elements absorb at their characteristic frequencies of light. Fun fact, helium was actually discovered inside the Sun spectroscopically before it was discovered on Earth, hence the name helium derived from the word helios, the Greek god of the Sun. However, if the star spins too fast, like most A stars do, then each little patch of the star has a huge Doppler shift, some parts being blue shifted and others red shifted. This causes the normally sharp spectroscopic features to smear out, and eventually they're so blurred you just can't distinguish them from one another anymore. AP stars are thus particularly interesting because they are the only A-type stars which we can reliably measure their chemical composition. The others are just spinning way too fast. So, what elements do we see in Przybylski's star then? Well, this was first measured by Polish astronomer Antoni Przybylski, hence the Slavic name that this star has, which I am sure I keep butchering the pronunciation of despite my best efforts. The first thing he noticed was that the star seems to have hardly any iron in it, which is weird, because that's usually a very common element manufactured easily in progenitor generations of stars. Iron is also one of the easiest things to detect, and it looks like this star has at least 10 times less iron than the Sun. Next, Przybylski noticed all sorts of exotic elements which really shouldn't be there. I mean, I'm talking lanthanum, cerium, praseodymium, neodymium, europium, gadolinium, terbium, dysprosium, holmium, erbium. Look, none of that stuff should be there beyond trace amounts, and yet Somehow, Przybylski's star is seemingly swimming in it.
It's been suggested that there is some kind of levitation effect going on here. Perhaps the quiescent radiative envelope, strong magnetic fields, and interaction with photons conspire to push specific elements up towards the surface, favoring certain elements over others dependent on how they absorb light. Although it's not a fully understood mechanism, hopefully that's enough that it might help you to sleep at night without worrying about Przybylski's star. But wait, it gets even weirder, because it is possible that this star has been deliberately salted. If you're wondering what a salted star even is, but are finding that the word salt is distracting you from thoughts of some delicious salty treat, well, let's scratch that itch with today's sponsor, and it's Element. Elementi, pronounced Element, make these powdered little electrolyte sachets in great flavors like orange, citrus, and watermelon. You just rip it open, chuck it in a bottle, add some water, give it a shake, and you're good to go. Element sent me these to try, and I loved it so much that I ended up buying a boatload more out of my own pocket before they even became a sponsor. So yes, I really do love this product. One reason is that I do 16-8 intermittent fasting, and so that means that in the mornings, I'm often craving something in my stomach, and Element reliably carries me through. I also usually work out just before lunch, and I can honestly say that having Element during that window is a game changer. It's just a few calories, it tastes delicious, especially if you love salt like I do, and it helps me power through those tough gym sessions. Personally, I get a lot more out of both fasting and working out by using Element, and so it has become a part of my routine. Try the product by using the link drinklmnt.com/coolworlds. That's drinklmnt.com/coolworlds. Link is down below in the description. You'll get a free sample box of a variety of flavors, no commitment needed, so you can start getting salty today. Thank you to Element for sponsoring us today, and also thank you for frankly helping me to discover this gem of a product. Now, back to the video. The Przybylski star doesn't just have weird chemical abundances, it has seemingly impossible abundances. In 2008, Ukrainian astronomer Vera Gopka and colleagues found that the star contains radioactive elements, things with half-lives of thousands or even hundreds of years. I'm talking actinium, protactinium, neptunium, plutonium, americium, curium, berkelium, californium, einsteinium. Stop. Seriously, just listen to these names. Berkelium, as in UC Berkeley, einsteinium, as in Albert Einstein, californium, as in California, and who can forget plutonium. These are all man-made elements. This is not stuff that you dig out of the ground, or stars for that matter. I mean, think about this. Actinium has a half-life of just 22 years, so what the hell is it doing inside a billion-year-old stellar atmosphere? That makes no sense. There's no fusion going on up there, there should be no mixing with the core for a radiative envelope like this, so the discovery of these elements here is flabbergasting, astonishing even. The presence of the short-lived elements so far from the core implies that nuclear reactions are somehow occurring near the surface of a star. Now, this can't be fusion, it's just nowhere near the temperature and pressure conditions needed. This stuff could only be made inside the most intense astrophysical events in the universe. Here's the astronomer's periodic table showing you where we think each element was made. As you can see, plutonium should only really be made by neutron star collisions. Notice how actinium, protactinium, and neptunium don't have any pathway. They just simply shouldn't exist at all in nature. Indeed, the authors don't even bother to consider anything heavier than plutonium because it's just so ridiculous. Yet, Przybylski's star has americium, curium, berkelium, californium, einsteinium. Why do I feel like I'm in a Monty Python sketch here? Anyway, how do we explain this? Now, as far as I'm aware, there are really only three viable explanations on the table. One, misinterpretation. Two, the island of stability. And three, Yes, you guessed it, aliens. The first one, misinterpretation, is obviously the most boring on that list, which perhaps means it's the most likely to be the case. The truth is, though, that we really don't know how these radioactive elements precisely absorb light. Why? Well, for context, just over 1 gram of berkelium has ever been produced in the United States since 1967. No one's ever actually put this stuff in a 10,000 Kelvin oven and measured how they absorb light. So the characteristic frequencies are theoretical, and it's quite possible that they are slightly wrong, and instead of seeing radioactive elements, we are instead seeing a far more mundane set of elements just behaving in an unexpected way. But it is also possible that those calculations are correct, and if so, we would have a monumental discovery on our hands. How could we possibly explain the presence of these heavy elements here? Nuclear reactions must be going on to provide a continuous supply of these short-lived radioactive elements. It can't be fusion because the conditions are just nowhere near extreme enough, so that leaves us with fission as the only viable option. But for something to make, say, Einsteinium this way, atomic number 99, it would necessarily have to be heavier than this. But therein lies the problem, because as far as we know, there is nothing stable beyond this point. Such synthesized elements decay within fleeting timescales. However, for decades, physicists have suggested that there could be an island of stability higher up the periodic table, elements with a so-called magic number of 184 neutrons. Possible candidates would be 298 fluorovium, 304 ubnil ilium, and 310 unbi hexium, where the latter two names are really just placeholder names at this point, since those two elements have never actually been synthesized in the lab. Several isotopes of fluorovium have been synthesized, but sadly not 298 fluorovium. The closest we've got is 290, which is still 8 neutrons shy. However, in that case, we do get a kind of respectable half-life of 19 seconds, and so maybe this implies that there is indeed a true island of stability just waiting for us out there, with half-lives of potentially up to 500 million years. This idea was first pitched by Vladimir Zuber and colleagues, who calculated the expected spectral line absorptions of these magic elements, so we know what to look for. The spectral analysis is very tricky though, and we haven't been able to really search for these methodically. I think it's only natural to be a little bit skeptical about this hypothesis. If Przybylski's star really does have fluorovium in it, then why don't we have that here on the Earth in even trace amounts? Was there some kind of special supernova event that explains this one star? Zuber's solution is neat, but for me, it really just pushes the problem down the road a little bit, since now we have a different mystery to explain. And so that leaves us with aliens. Oh, you know, it's always a little bit unsatisfying when you have to invoke aliens to explain something that you don't yet understand. This is God of the Gaps mentality. But hear me out, I think the case of Przybylski's star is perhaps a little bit more compelling than usual. The idea is that these radioactive elements are there because someone dumped them into the star, deliberately. One motivation could be waste disposal, as depicted in Superman 4. Nuclear waste disposal is, of course, a real and very major problem, so perhaps throwing it into your star is indeed a solution for some civilizations. Whitmer and Wright first suggested this, and they also said that the most promising stars to look at would be between spectral types of F2 to A5, and although there is some uncertainty about exactly what type Przybylski's star is, it's almost certainly in this range. What makes this particularly interesting is that Whitmer and Wright suggested this back in 1980, but Viragopka didn't detect those radioactive elements until 2008, so this is apparently a prediction of alien behavior that was later observed. In fact, if we go even further back than that, in 1966, Carl Sagan and Yossos Shklovsky proposed that aliens might deliberately salt their star as a way of attracting attention. In either scenario, it means that someone lives around Przybylski's star now and is actively dumping radioactive elements into the star as part of an ongoing process. So, what to make of all of this? Well, first, I would love to see some new spectra confirming the existence of these radioactive elements. That claim is particularly sensational and difficult to explain. Second, even if confirmed, we need to better understand the absorption frequencies of these heavy elements. Is it possible that these are just mirages, deceiving us due to our limited understanding? And third, personally, I'd want to investigate the possible planets around this star, as well as its overall environment in better detail. This star has not received anywhere near the same amount of attention or fanfare that Boyajian star received, but there's something here, something is out of place. Whatever the answer, it promises to deeply shift our astrophysics understanding. Perhaps there is some exotic nuclear process going on in this star, or maybe an island of stability, or perhaps a bizarre origin story to this star. Or maybe, just maybe, there's someone there, 357 light years away, busy salting their star, looking up and wondering whether anyone lives here. An unimaginable discovery that's just waiting for us. So, until next time, stay thoughtful and stay curious. Thank you so much for watching this video, everybody. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, be sure to give it a like. It really does help us with the algorithm. And if you really want to help us out, you can become a donor to my research team, the Cool Worlds Lab, right here at Columbia University, just like our latest supporter, that is Axel Nimajan. Thank you so much for your support. See you next time.